to those.
It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes it will.
All right, Lisa Caston, it's 153 days now since LaMelo was shot down in Biloxi and nobody's done anything yet. There's been no movement, absolutely no movement. It is in the hands of the Biloxi PD and the district attorney here in Mississippi. And the investigation continues as to who shot that child. Yet I think there's some movement there in Pearlington regarding a mother and a so-called stepfather boyfriend who's now been accused of murder of a two-year-old?
Boyfriend, yeah. New charges for the mother and her boyfriend there. His charges being enhanced to include the murder charge, and she also faces a murder charge as well.
Hmm. Boy, they really are investigating that one, huh? I guess that's an easy one. Of course, they had to find the child miles away from where the child was taken, kidnapped, killed, I don't know, there in Louisiana, Baton Rouge. LaMelo came from Baton Rouge as well, just outside of Baton Rouge, huh?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Good police work on the part of Louisiana, one could argue, and good police work on the part of the Pearlington police officers, I guess, who somehow or another were able to find this baby in Log Road. Still no idea as to the details of the killing, but someone's been arrested. We got a lot of movement on that, bro.
Yeah, even a narrative as to how this all came about. Apparently, the two-year-old grabbed the mother's contact lenses from the bathroom as she was getting ready for work. The mother gets upset, punches the two-year-old in the stomach.
Really?
Yeah. Which caused the two-year-old to fall and hit her head on the cabinet. According to police reports, Gardner and Cardwell, the boyfriend and the mother, so-called, then took the two-year-old, Nevaeh Allen, into another room. The father observed the two-year-old crying and noticed the bruise on her forehead. He then took the mother to work and returned home with the baby. The baby refused to eat, complaining that she was suffering from stomach pain. She then laid down and was then found unresponsive. According to Gardner, the boyfriend, he attempted to render CPR to the baby, Allen, who was cold and lifeless. Gardner did not call 911. He did not contact authorities or even the child's mother. He left his cell phone at his home so police couldn't track it. Gardner then went on to say that he put Allen into a suitcase and loaded her into the car and drove to Mississippi to dispose of her remains and then the suitcase.
When he threw the baby in the river or the swamp or whatever it is, it looks like there's a bayou or something near there. I mean, Pearlington has got riddled with them.
Yeah, marshland. Forensic pathologist stated that while the baby had severe trauma causing brain swelling, it cannot be ruled out that the victim was still alive at the time she was placed in the suitcase, possibly suffocated to death.
You'd be judged, America, about how you treat infants and elderly. What do you do with this? I mean, there's a special place in hell for any child that would kill his parent, but any mother who would kill her daughter. Any boyfriend who would participate in that. Both are charged now with, second degree murder, third degree? What degree is it? I don't know. Is it murder, just murder?
Getting the exact charges.
We got all the details, though, didn't we?
Yeah, now.
I guess we don't have the same when it comes to this three-month-old. Wonder why.
No.
I mean, investigators are very, that's very thorough. Obviously, the so-called stepfather is really, he's trying to see why.
Yeah.
I didn't do it.
Yeah. And that's a second degree murder.
Really?
Both.
See, that's exactly why I do not support the death penalty, folks. I just, there's no degrees of murder. Murder's murder. Murder's murder. And I'm an equal opportunity executioner. I just really am, folks. There's no excuse. You can be blind. You can be crazy. You can be whatever. If, in fact, you knew not to stick yourself in your eye, then you are sane enough to face the death penalty, as far as I'm concerned. Look, I'm just hard about it. I really am. Eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth. There's no degrees. Now, if, in fact, you're the kind of person who has to wear a helmet and would be, I'd be afraid of your hurting yourself, different story. Maybe you're unaware. But if you're not hurting yourself as much as you're hurting someone else, then you are aware. You can tell that you don't want to be treated that way. My God. So is he trying to suggest that it was an accident? I mean, she punched her 2-year-old in the stomach.
Yeah.
And then we're supposed to believe that that the 2-year-old girl just hit her head?
Yeah.
How can we believe anything these folks say? That was first degree. How do they describe the second degree murder? What is that? Unintentional, just so happens I punched in the stomach, but I wasn't really trying to kill her?
Yeah, the unpremeditated but intentional killing of another person.
This is our society, folks, and I know it doesn't mean that you are that way. I know that. But this is what I mean by mores. This is what I mean by mores. You know, the whole idea of what society will and will not accept, the outrage, right? And there's a lot of times it's those mores and the outrage that prevent people from doing exactly this. No, I wouldn't dare punch my child in the stomach because, oh, God, what everybody would say, even if it's not a matter of the punishment, because some people can't really grasp second-degree murder could mean that you will spend some time in jail. But, boy, they'll talk about me on Facebook. I won't be able to go home to my family, and I'll be, I can't punch her in the stomach. The only reason for really not, this is my first time hearing that detail, bro. When you just said it was the first time I heard it. Is it in here on something? I don't have it.
You're not there. Well, I'll get it to you.
Well, no, you don't have to. The gory details of that is enough. Mm. So the boyfriend is suggesting that he was trying to revive the child? Gave
according to him,
you believe that?
Attempted to render CPR. Absolutely not. I don't believe any of this story.
I can't wait to hear the story on 3-month-old LaMelo. I wonder when that's going to come out. Biloxi PD. Sean Tindall, Commissioner of Public Safety. Sheriff Peterson. Chief Riles. When do you think that story's going to come out?
Well, and here's the thing with that. We're not asking about even what happened in Louisiana. We know we won't get that story in full. We know that. We're asking what happened on I-10. Mm-hmm. We see it. We need to know how and why it happened. And who caused it to.
Yeah. Who's responsible? There's no doubt that Smith driving the car was certainly responsible for driving there.
Yeah, but I mean, until I see, you know, forensic evidence or clear videographic evidence showing that he fired the first shot, he is not responsible for his son being dead or himself being dead. He should be paying for the killing of that child's mother and her nephew.
Hmm. All right, got a lot to impart, folks. A lot happening on Capitol Hill inside the Beltway. Obviously, it looks like our nation has been funded. The debt ceiling has been raised at least till December, which means we're not going to shut down. You realize raising the debt ceiling is to pay bills that were made during the Donald John administration, the last fiscal year for the most part, right? And that was a whole lot of spending, even before the pandemic. This man was averaging $1 trillion a year over budget. We budget for X, we're going to spend $1 trillion more on your credit card. And not one fiscal conservative said a damn thing. And every time he went in and wanted to raise the debt ceiling, it was okay, yeah, fine. And now Mitch McConnell is balking. Now he wants to now say this is just too much. How much is too much? Never, they gave the man everything he wanted. I'm just going to tell you. Even for his wall, remember?
Yep.
They took money from the defense, from the Department of Defense. Let me just tell you, this is why, you know, you guys, you Republican conservative guys have lost your soul. You let this guy take money from the military to give to his contractor buddies, who right now, ladies and gentlemen, listen to me, who right now have indictments against him. One of which, a participant, Bannon, who made out like a fat rat with millions, was pardoned without even being charged.
Preemptive pardon.
You know, hero. What? What do you say to him? Huh? I mean, you've just lost your soul. There's no credibility with this bunch. There is no credibility. And they can't understand why people like Rip Daniels, who's an open-minded, free-thinking, commonsensical guy. You can call me liberal, you can call me left, you can call me whatever you want, but I'm not going to come. But there's no way in the world any so real conservative person, which I am, by the way, any waste not, want not, you know what I mean? Penny save, penny earn. That's what conservatism is, you see. You know, be not the first to whom the new is tried, nor the last to lay the old aside. I told you about all this. You know, all things in moderation. It is a best, you know, I kind of go it slow, you know. There's no way in the world you guys can ever take the high ground for people who have common sense. Any intelligent individual would look at this and go, really? This guy spent more in his first year on vacation and on the golf course than any other president in the history of this country, even beyond Bush. I mean, really. No one can argue with it. He sit there and let cops get the heck beat out of him for 5 hours and then say that those who were beating them were patriots. And by the way, now I understand that the Select Committee now has subpoenaed the sponsors of that rally. Can't wait to see them. Plus a few other subpoenas of individuals. So. I mean, it's just incomprehensible. But I want to go into something because I hopefully in this show, I will help individuals who are bigots and don't know they are. And I want you to know you are. Because I really think that, you know, you probably in earnest, you really have not thought this through beyond your wanting to believe what you know, and in the back of your mind, you know is false. Got me? But it makes you feel good, at least to go to the deer camp and actually rub elbows and other individuals. I mean, no one wants to feel, I guess, guilty about being an a-hole. You know what I mean? You don't. And you don't want to admit it. Although you know you are. You know? But you just assume be around a bunch of other a-holes. And I'm sorry if I'm being a little insulting for you ladies. I do apologize because I know mostly men are that. But they usually circle themselves with that. You know what I'm saying? With people mm-hmm. who are doing wrong, there's this, like you have a criminal subculture. You have mm-hmm. a subculture of a-holes mm-hmm. who just, you know, they go to the golf course, they rub elbows, mm-hmm. they do the same thing, say the same, you know, racial jokes.
Mm-hmm. Holes of a feather.
There you go, holes of a feather. Yes, thank you. Thank you for that. I needed that. You know, you stick together.
Yeah.
And
sometimes get stuck together.
And so I'm gonna explain to you. You know, I'm going to help you with that. I really am. So that you will understand why those of us who are not like you look at you as being utter and complete a-holes. And dangerous, too, by the way. Well, we think you're dangerous. I don't mind saying it. Now, some handkerchief head Negroes north of 20 or maybe on the other side of the Pascagoula River will, you know, just walk around and be scared. You know, they have accepted the fact that of what you are, and so now they humble themselves, and we just got to get along. Oh, what are we going to do? Just see if we can make a little money off of them. That's it, Rip. They're going to be here. Rip is not that way. No. I accept the fact that I have to deal with people like you and compete with you and defeat you every day. I'm okay with it, too. And trust me, I wouldn't be here if it was not for a whole lot of victories. I'm not bragging about it. Not at all. It is expected of me as an American to fight for my freedom every day. The problem is for you is that I enjoy it. Ooh, I enjoy that, bro. Don't we?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, we enjoy that.
Immensely.
Something about kicking ass that just makes you feel good the next day, doesn't it?
It does.
It don't feel good when you lose.
No.
It don't feel good.
It really sucks the next day.
And you only lose when you give up.
Yeah.
You know, I always look at it the next day, okay, you'll see my face. Here I am. I'm back again. Let's see if you win today. Let's just see if you whoop this one today. I didn't figure you out now. Oh, yeah. I refuse to be negative, folks. I'm not going to be that. You know, when you come from humble beginnings, as did I, from a father who built his own house here in Jim Crow, Mississippi, and didn't owe a dime when he opened that door, trust me, you know something about achieving. You know something about, the conservative concept of if you don't have something, make do with what you got. We do that pretty well down here, don't we, Ro?
Oh, yeah.
We open this radio station in the closet, literally. And I'm not bragging. I'm just hopefully encouraging some of you who don't have that much to work with to understand that you have no other choice but to succeed. Failure is not an option for you. When you were born, you were in a failed situation. Your only direction is up. My mama said you're strongest when you're down. Get the hell up. Stand up. James Brown said you're only blind by those people who are standing up. Stop laying down. But I have to tell you about this story. We had been talking about vaccinations. And look, folks, you guys who are hell-bent on not taking it, okay, I ain't trying to convince you. I will tell you this. I don't feel comfortable around you. And we just keep our distance from each other. We cool. We really are. I wear my bandana. You wear your mask. Let's just not talk that much. We can just talk on the radio. There's a 16-year-old boy dead. Now Mississippi's got, their pediatrics, around 9 kids dead between, 11 and 17? You would say that's not many, wouldn't you? Well, compare that with the number of children who died from, the flu, or this year, or colds. But this saga of the last days of this 16-year-old from Pontotoc is just very, very touching, bro. It really, really is. Do you have the story over there?
Yeah, I have the story and the reporting
no
in
COVID.
Real time. Thank you. Mm. The reporting in real time also from his mother via Facebook. But here's a story out of WTVA.
The mother of a North Pontotoc High School football player announced on Facebook recently her 16-year-old son died from COVID. WTVA's Brianna Bynum is live at North Pontotoc High School in Ecru, where the school will hold a vigil tomorrow morning.
I spoke with several people here in Ecru today, and they all said that Landon Woodson was a great person. An online obituary said Woodson died on Saturday at LeBonner's Children's Hospital in Memphis. Now his mother took to social media to urge everyone to get the vaccine. Now, Woodson was a sophomore here at the school and played on the varsity football team. There are several signs around North Pontotoc High in remembrance of Woodson that students signed and hung across campus. One of Woodson's friends said they often bonded over their love for football.
It was the reason why I wanted to go further and play college football. Talking about him and seeing him get excited within himself, I noticed sometimes that I would sometimes get excited too, just talking about the game with him. It was like a motivating factor for me.
The school will hold a moment of silence and remembrance tomorrow morning at 7:40. Anyone who attends is asked to wear red. Live in Ecru, Brianna Bynum, WTVA 9 News.
I was just shocked with how quickly this young life was taken.
Yeah.
And this is a strong boy.
Strong, strapping young football player there up in Ecru.
This is him right here on my Facebook, man.
His mother, Tracy Young, documented this thing, and that just shows her incredible strength. I don't know if I would be able to do this. But this whole thing started on the 22nd.
Of September?
Of September, just earlier in the month here. And she posts a very simple but fervent Facebook post stating on the 22nd at 3:18 a.m., please, please say prayers for my son. He is headed to hospital in ambulance. We hear from her later that morning at 9:13. She states, can't stand to see my baby like this. Pray, 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 please. I will die if I lose my baby. Again, that evening at 7:08 p.m. on September 22nd, update, my son is stable. He's in ICU at Le Bonheur. His vital signs are good. He is still on a ventilator. These prayers for my son is greatly appreciated. Just please continue to pray. Thank you all who have reached out and prayed. And then she's documenting herself being at Le Bonheur Children's Hospital. Later that evening,
the 23rd,
the next morning on 23rd, she is, stating that, she's with, she said, quote, I am with my baby. This has always been my worst nightmare, being helpless. She then states some motivational posts, some motivational memes later that evening at 5:42 PM on the 23rd. Don't quit. Someone is praying for you right now and you will make it through this. God is on your side. Amen. Later that evening, she posts some old pics of her son playing football. Hmm. Then at 7:57 p.m. on September 23rd, she posts, I'm going to try and rest. He's still sedated and stable. His ventilator was turned down to 50%, which is good. They are going to ease him off sedation meds a little bit at a time so he won't freak out. I love this tough young man. He is truly a mama's boy. Then on the 23rd at 9 p.m., she posts a then and now picture of her son, the picture of him in his Vikings jersey on the field holding a football on one side, him on his what would be his deathbed on the other side, intubated. Quoting, he has never been in the hospital. He's always been healthy until COVID. Please, please get vaccinated. Hmm. The next morning, please, prayers, please.
It's the 24th.
24th, yes, sir. 11:40 a.m. Prayers, please. They are doing a CT scan to check his mental state. On the 24th at 1:43 p.m. later that afternoon, my baby, my baby. I love him so much. I can't do this anymore. I love all my babies. My bonus children, I love you all with all my heart. I can't live without my son, my baby Landon. He is not going to make it. I won't. I want to die right now. I can't leave this hospital without him. Then on the 24th, she posts another profile picture at 9:14 p.m., switching her profile picture to that field picture of her son later that evening.
Ellen.
Posting a picture of him and a friend, possibly that friend you just heard in the news report, number 5, on the football field there. One of my friends, quoting, one of my friends sent me this. I never knew my son had so many friends. Then on the 25th of September, she posts that picture again. And later in that afternoon at 4:33 p.m., she posts, my baby, my precious son, I'm so broken. I can't breathe without this child. He is being taken off of ventilator and everything. We are letting God have him. Now I can't say goodbye.
So that was September 25th?
September 25th at 4:33 p.m. She does not post again until September 27th, just a few days ago at noon with his arrangements. Landon's viewing and funeral services will be at Blue Mountain Cemetery.
So he died September 25th. He was confirmed dead. 17-year-old strapping buck. Look, I'm not going to argue with you. I'm going to give you just a real small, real simplistic statistic. How Rip Daniels came to realize that he probably will get COVID and he needs to now think about how he survives it. Here is how. And it's very simple. I want you to consider the 10 people you around, usually. It could be in your house. It could be in your work. There are approximately 10 people, maybe 20, but let's just say 10 people that you are going to come in contact usually in the course of a day. If not in contact with them directly, you will be wherever they're going to be. Same room, same house, same car, same bus. And let's just say half of them were diagnosed with COVID-19. Half of the 10, that's 5 people, got COVID-19. Out of the 10 people that's around you, half of them got COVID-19. There's a 50% chance you're going to get COVID-19. You got me? There's a 50% chance you're going to get COVID-19. If one of those individuals die, there's a 1 in 10 chance that you're going to probably die. Now, you just have to roll the dice. Now, if you feel lucky, it's okay. But if you get snake eyes, then you know what that means. But that's what brought me to understand that, you know, what I got to do is get some defenses here. And the vaccine is one of them. The mask is one of them. Test is one of them. My environment, my distance is one of them. So what I need is something that's going to help me defend myself against this enemy that is delivered by my friends, by people that I know and work with. They can inadvertently give me this disease just by talking. Just by shaking my hand. Usually by talking, though. So you've got to decide, based on the number of people around you that have had it, or has it, what is the probability of your getting it? Right? What is the probability of your getting it? And then do accordingly. You don't have to argue with Rip Daniels. You don't have to go on Facebook. You want to do some research. Research what's around you right now and ask yourself how many people you know have died and or have come down with it in your first those who are around you and then those in your extended view. I know at least I can tell you right now in my family there's 50%. I just had a grandson, just got over it. You know, he didn't know he had it. It's completely asymptomatic. Young, strapping buck, what, he's 11 years old? And now a nephew who last Saturday died. Now, he had come down with COVID and had to be airlifted to the hospital. And then that was during the summer. Now, I don't know what the reason why he died. He had some other pre-existing conditions. Could have been a long hauler. I don't know. But trust me on this. Your enemy is not the CDC. It's not Fauci. It's not Rip Daniels. It's not those who are vaccinated against the anti-vaccinated. Come on. You have a disease in front of you. You got to decide how you're going to survive it. It's okay, whatever you do, you know, vitamin B, vitamin D, do all of that. The question I would ask you is why would you not consider every possibility, every bit of armor you can put on you to defend yourself against the enemy?
Precisely.
I mean, it's sort of like, you know, my head is hard enough, so I should be able to get into the game without a helmet.
You don't need no helmet. You don't need no helmet. What you got a skull for, you need a helmet.
Ain't no guarantee that it's going to stop me from getting a concussion. I can stand up. I could fake real good. They ain't going to catch me. It's okay. I get it. I can get that. Can you play without a helmet? Well, yeah. You in the game of play, if your helmet comes off, they don't just blow the whistle. I mean, unless you're going down, of course.
Yeah.
So I'm not trying to convince you. I'm just simply saying you do the stats. Go. It's a roulette table. What is the chances of me getting it, and what is the chances of my surviving it? My conclusion was drawn based upon, you know, my age, and I'm a strapping buck now. There's no doubt about that. I think I'll survive it, but I don't need to get that sick, right? I don't want to get that sick. I don't have time for that even. Who want to get sick? So you decide. I had someone to take me to task and say, well, Rip, what's the possibilities of your dying and everything else? I want you to know, we decided to pull up the stats. And this is going back to U.S. death tolls from COVID-19. This is U.S. causes of death in 2019. We didn't even, this is not even 2020. Last year was 2020. Now, so this has obviously changed, bro. I mean, you realize that by March 11th, COVID-19 deaths was the third leading cause of death? Is that what I'm reading here?
Yes.
This is from Political Facts. Let's see. All of the causes of death pale in comparison to coronavirus death toll. So far, the coronavirus has killed roughly three times as many people as accidents, lung ailments, stroke, Alzheimer's disease, or anything else.
And that was just for that year.
That's incredible. But they go into 2020, though. It says here, and the coronavirus has outpaced the number of deaths from diabetes, kidney disease, pneumonia, suicide, by even larger multiples. Here's what you've got to understand, and I'm going to leave this alone. This show is not going to be about that. We're going to go some other directions. But here's what you got to understand, you naysayers. You see, the virus is an infection. So, like, you get a bobo, and you get the pus and so forth. That's an infection. Now, the first thing is you got a bobo. That could be heart disease. That could be diabetes. It could be high blood pressure. That's your bobo. The infection is what causes it to get worse. In other words, you can die from staph infection, for instance, but this virus is an infection that complicates even that. It gets in, right? And it makes that high blood pressure worse, and then, of course, it makes its way on down to your heart. I'm just explaining it to you. Instead of looking at the virus itself as being the killer is actually what it does to the other ailments that you have. It makes them worse. Ultimately, you get pneumonia and you die of COVID.
On top of it being as deadly as it is on its own, more recent number here real quick, COVID-19, the fourth leading cause of death globally.
Really?
Really.
What is the first? Is it heart disease?
Ischemic heart disease, yes, sir.
Yeah.
15.4%.
And then cancer problem?
Stroke, actually.
Stroke.
Ischemic heart disease, stroke, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, and then COVID.
And stroke is actually related to heart disease, actually. I mean, it's a blood circulatory.
Can be related to heart disease and diabetes in some cases.
I was shocked to see that it even dwarfs accidents. I would thought that for sure. It used to be accidents and even suicide. All right, so go ahead and take your chance. You don't have to call Rip Daniels and you don't have to explain to me what happened was, and this is why I don't believe it, and what about this? They told me this and then they told me that. It's okay. I got it, but you just do the numbers. Look at the percentages of those folks you know who have had it, who have died, and ask yourself, what's your chance?
And that was globally. It's number two in the U.S. after heart disease.
It's not if you get it, it's when you get it. We'll be back.
Get the info. Get the info.
Stay informed. It's a new day with Rip Daniels, the number one talk show in South Mississippi on Jay-Z 94.5.
Tonight, a new urgent CDC health alert for pregnant women, urging them to get a COVID vaccine. New data show that symptomatic pregnant women have more than a twofold increased risk of requiring ICU admission and a 70% increased risk of death.
The impact of the COVID-19 disease on pregnancy can be profound in a negative way. On the woman who's pregnant herself, is at high risk for a severe outcome for COVID for her. The negative impact on the fetus is also very clear right now.
Only around 1 in 3 pregnant women nationwide are vaccinated right now. Across the country, public health officials are stepping up their push and, in some cases, requirements to force people to get the shot. Mark Bischofsky is a respiratory therapist in Minnesota.
We had signs outside of our hospital, "I was a hero." Right now, I feel expendable.
He's now one of more than 180 healthcare workers in the state suing their employers to stop vaccine mandates.
To me, really irresponsible to put this mandate in place without accommodations for the people that have already had COVID and for the folks that have religious exemptions.
Today, YouTube said it was banning all anti-vaccine misinformation from its platform, reigniting a heated debate over free speech, censorship, and public safety as more companies hit vaccination deadlines. United Airlines says it's firing nearly 600 employees for refusing to get vaccinated.
It's just a matter of choice. Now, I'm vaccinated. I believe in a vaccine, but I also believe in people's opportunity to decide whether to get vaccinated.
United CEO says travel won't be impacted.
Such a small percentage, and we planned and prepared for this.
But in upstate New York, where a vaccine mandate for healthcare workers took effect this week, some doctors are already sounding the alarm about a staffing shortage.
It is absolutely a staffing crisis. There's no question about it. It's real.
And that's how it is in America on this day, September 30th, 2021. Still dealing with this. Why? I'll tell you why. Because we didn't stop the spread in the first place. Not stopping the spread now. All right, good morning. Rip Daniels here. Thank you for joining us. The show is called It's a New Day. There's one rule. No such thing as a right or wrong opinion here, folks. Look, do I think that people should be vaccinated? Well, yeah. I do. I think that there are some jobs that should be questioned. Do I think that there should be some consideration for those who already had COVID and they should be tested for antibodies? Well, yeah. I believe that. I really do. However, I also believe, ladies and gentlemen, that because of the fact that we're dealing in an environment that we don't know. We don't know. Scientists don't know. Doctors don't know. It is important that we arm ourselves with whatever is necessary that helps to spread to others. You got me? And that's what this is about. This is about an enemy that can attack all of us at any given time and can change at any given time. And the only way we are able to stop that enemy is prevention, right? Not be there, you know? Or be there, but have on the arms necessary to stop it. And so look, it's not just about you. It's about what you're giving to someone else. If I can't blow smoke in your face, then don't blow COVID in mine. And how would you know you're not, right? There you go. And the only way we do that is, in my view, a test. And then nothing's foolproof until such time that you get to the point where fewer and fewer people have it. I don't doubt that that's happening now, Ro. The numbers are of infections now, at least those are getting diagnosed, is going down somewhat. The deaths are not going down, however, particularly among children and the hospitalization of children. They're going up. And so there you have it. 228-896-9455. Go ahead.
Well, I just, one's going down, one's going up. And I'm not going to, you know, speculate on the fudging of the numbers. We know there's some manipulation there, of course. But that would lead me to believe that there is not as much being done to prevent infection. So beyond just, you know, folks not getting vaccinated, folks aren't masking. Folks aren't social distancing, because those are the easiest things you could do, yet the infections are going up. For whatever reason, despite however many children we've lost now in this state due to COVID, two more here being reported today, this state is not taking this virus seriously, at least not as seriously as it should be.
And two more pregnant women.
And two more pregnant women, right. Yeah. And the numbers bear that out.
Well, Ocean Springs now has dropped their mask mandate. Too bad for you, Ocean Springs. If I was an Ocean Springs parent, I would still send my child to school with a mask, knowing that child is going to bit more wear that mask. you're going to have the mask on most of the time, some of the time, but at the very least, it's going to be just a little help to keep COVID from coming from a maskless child. You know what I mean?
Every little bit helps, but...
Yeah, I mean, this whole idea of somehow or another, they're walking around with masks and it's glued to their face and they can't breathe. That's so silly. I've seen the kids getting off school buses, masked down below their chin, just like any other adult. You know what I mean? However, you know, when someone coughs, they might take a little more seriously. You know what I mean? So, you know, every little bit kind of helps, you know, and so.
I'm sure they're happy to have that mask down around their chin when someone coughs and not.
So, you know, that it, we've seen that whenever we start to lax is when the numbers go up. It would stand to reason the best thing to do is to stay vigilant, right? Until such time that you really do have some significant, reductions in numbers. And even then, say, all right, let me take my time. I will always have my bandana now, folks, henceforth, even after COVID. I will. Just never can tell when someone's going to cough around me, and I just want, well, this is the way to do it. It's a little close in here. I think I put my bandana on. Now, of course, I guess once COVID's gone, they'll look at me as a bandit, I guess. But I'm glad to brought up Ocean Springs because there was a board meeting last night that someone wanted me to weigh in. I did see the story on WLOX, the local news, and there's a curriculum that is being put forward in Ocean Springs that gives considerations for socialization among students. How do you respond to someone? And what pronouns to use? All right, this whole in this world of being open-minded and consideration of all people. And I don't mind, I'll weigh in on it, but we've got time. I'm going to get to this critical race theory thing, and this kind of goes into that. But there is a curriculum that basically helps teachers to handle their lessons, let's put it that way, with consideration for students' interaction with each other. Now, you know, first let me just say this. I think teachers, period, need to get out of the socialization skills. I really do. However, you can't ignore the fact that they're dealing with children and they are going to socialize. You know, you know, students who are in grade school are not taught sociology. You got me? However, in an effort to help children get along and understand, let's see, history and science and the differences, why is it that Negroes don't get lice? I mean, one has to ask. I mean, the children going to ask. I mean, I had to ask, well, why is his skin that color? Why does he turn red when I hit him? Why is that? I never seen a child do that. I mean, the first time you do that to a white kid is stunning. He turned red. And how could he hold his breath and then turn red? And what is flush? And so his eyes is blue. Does he only see blue? Children ask questions like that. And sometimes they ask it of their teachers, and their teachers need to have an explanation. Well, there are some parents who feel that you need to send the child home for that. Don't ask a teacher that, or that a teacher should not give their observations or their answers to that. I don't feel that way. I do feel, however, that there are some areas, particularly when it comes down to sex and growing up, that teachers need to say, well, ask your mama or ask your daddy. I mean, even my mama would say, ask my daddy sometime, and vice versa, my dad would say, go ask your mama. You know, with questions that we feel they'd be better qualified to answer. You know, at this point, how a child acts out, be it sexually or otherwise, is not a teacher's business, in my view. And so, therefore, the teacher should say, you should talk to your mama about that. But we'll get to it. The person who sent this to me, I see what your concerns are. And I'll give the benefit of the discussion. Also, Herbie, you want to weigh in on Joe Biden. We'll be back.
Get the info. Stay informed. It's a new day with Rip Daniels, the number one talk show in South Mississippi on Jay-Z 94.5.
Yeah, it's the Pied Piper of R&B, y'all.
Whoa.
Follow me. Chicago and them.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Don Juan and them.
Yeah. What?
It's okay, so, right?
Can we play R. Kelly now?
Said I know that it's somebody's birthday tonight.
I mean, mean, he's been convicted.
And I know somebody's gonna celebrate tonight.
Gotta be sentenced in May.
Somewhere, yeah.
I know one thing's for sure. I'm gonna put on my dancing shoes. Then I'ma hit the door and go out and step.
Yeah.
The whole night through.
At Chuck E. Cheese.
He is gonna be stepping. Then I'm gonna kind of shuffling.
Very much so.
In orange.
I'm gonna step
in the name of love.
In the name of love.
Stepping in that shower might be a little risky, though. Huh? All right, good morning, folks. Rip Daniels here. I mean, has the censor people said that we could play R. Kelly now?
I don't think so. I'm just bold.
Need to check over there in Diamond Head and just see if
it's you need to check it.
Let us know if we... Well, I know we just played it, but if you say we can't, then we won't.
Then we won't.
We don't want to insult anybody. I mean, you know, the music is still good. I mean, we still played Michael Jackson after he was... Well, he wasn't convicted, but accused and had some settlement out of a civil court with some parents of little boys. Still was an incredible singer. I mean, if you knew what Bach and Beethoven were doing, trust me on this, and their proclivities. Let me just tell you about utilizing girls from orphanages. I'm just saying. All right, 228-896-9455. We're going to get to that story here out of Ocean Springs, but Herbie's been waiting in the wings here, as usual. Good morning, Herbie. How are you?
Good morning, Rick and Eddie. If Trump was the one that came out and promoting this shot like he, you know, like Biden is doing, I wouldn't even take the shot, you know, even though I once voted for Trump. But I would be calling this shot the Biden shot. Because you can't call it the Trump and Biden shot, because Trump is not promoting it as much as Biden. So with Biden, it's similar to Obamacare, where he's going to fight for this shot the whole time he's in office. When we had the George Floyd bill in, and all the things that's going on at the border and the race relationships here in America. You know, he has a history, you know, Biden, with that crime bill. So, you know, in judgment towards black people and it being called the Biden bill, I think it'll help a lot of the brothers understand which Biden mindset is for the black people.
You obviously don't understand. Bill,
you know,
Herbie, you obviously don't understand. You really, brother, you're in quicksand. You realize George Floyd was killed under the guy you voted for, and he chose not to investigate George Floyd. The guy you voted for came out.
We're not doing anything about it now. We're not voting for another guy.
Brother, excuse me, brother. The person that is in office now has an African American woman over the Civil Rights Division, and every other shot that has been made by law enforcement, particularly as it applies to race, is being investigated. I mean, surely you know this, but obviously it doesn't.
You take the shot if it was.
What I'm going to do is just hang up on you and move on, because it just gets to the point where it just gets so boring. It just gets boring, Herbie, and I know you don't want to be boring. Would I take the shot? I already took the shot. You don't want to take the shot? I'm not trying to convince you.
If Trump was promoted.
I want you to know, because Trump did do the so-called warp speed, caused some suspicions from me, brother. However, what I did was evaluate the number of people around me who have COVID. What about you? How many people in your immediate sphere has had COVID?
Well, I think I'll take the shot if two things are happening. If Biden go back and let all the brothers out of jail.
Thank you very much. What?
Why did you hang
up? I just did. Someone go get Herbie and take him back to Picayune. You ain't know he ain't supposed to be in Moss Point. Moss Point is too urbanized for her.
I'm getting a text from Picky on this.
I don't.
We don't want him.
Come on, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. Herbie, come on. You just got to give it a break, brother. Give it a break. Let me tell you what I like about Joe Biden. He owns up. I do like that. He's just going to be straight one way or the other. He ain't going to be on the golf course. You know, you can talk about him, say whatever you want, but he's going to go that same old straight line. Say what you want. And trust me, the 94 crime bill was not his bill. It was our bill. And most point fared out a whole lot better under the 94 crime bill. Trust me on that, my brother. It really did. But no matter what, be it Biden, be it Donald John, I was very suspicious. That whole warp speed thing was it was more Nancy Pelosi and the Congress passing the $2 trillion, close to $3 trillion CARES Act that resulted in warp speed being able to happen, because that's where the money came from. That's where the money came from to actually encourage 30 to 40,000 people between here and Great Britain to take the vaccine experimentally. You realize, and there are those of us who went to college who know this, that you know you can make some money on the side by participating in experimental drugs.
Yeah.
And the whole warp speed thing was getting a large enough group to take it to actually draw a conclusion, get the data right up front. Typically, you don't have that many people. You need 30, 40,000, 50,000 people can take a drug that they don't know is going to work, a vaccine. You have a placebo, and then you have the drug, and then you do the comparison. Typically, that takes a long time, 4, 5, 6 years, because you can't get as many people to participate because you don't have enough money to put on the street. They had enough money, thanks to, actually, the Nancy Pelosi and Republican and Democrats in Congress back this time. Well, actually, it was in July last year with the CARES Act. A significant amount of money went to hospitals and research and to those companies like Moderna and Johnson & Johnson and others who took the warp speed money, not Pfizer. Pfizer didn't take the money. They went ahead and developed it themselves. But that's how it came to be. It was getting warp speed was not like you actually jump on the Enterprise and hit a button and see all those beautiful colors behind you as you lunge through space. Warp speed was, okay, we want to get a big enough investigation of this vaccine to draw a conclusion that it works or that it doesn't. So we got to get enough guinea pigs to do that. Quick break. We'll be back. Miss Faye, Bobby, you're next.
WJZD-FM Long Beach, D'Iberville, Pascagoula, Biloxi, the all-new Jay-Z 94.5.
Have thought. I really want to. Can you go ahead and play this? I know I've got folks waiting in the wings here, but I want to play a local station piece here on Ocean Springs curriculum that's now being challenged, it's the usual folks who are challenging it. You know, let me just tell you, Oxygen Conservative Talk Radio has convinced their listeners that there is a boogeyman called the left or the liberal or whatever. You got me? They have convinced them that being conservative means being a saint. Being conservative means being not just American, but a real American. And there are some who just take that indoctrination and love it. And I'm going to share with you before the show is over the folly of that. But they see it as a difference, right? And use some false equivalencies, and I'll get more into that. But you know, the whole idea of critical race theory, or the whole idea that teachers are teaching some kind of curriculum that will inadvertently harm the, I guess it would be the self-esteem, would harm the self-esteem of their children is far more appalling than their child making a D. You know what I mean? You wanna harm their self-esteem, give them an F or a D or a C. You know, but for them, a teacher verbalizing whatever it is worse than that. And then, of course, the oxyconservative talk has led those to believe that somehow every college is like Berkeley, UCLA, or every professor is so-called liberal. And trust me, I went to Eckerd College in St. Petersburg, Florida, and a few others between here and taking courses, JD, USM. And most of my professors were not even close to being quote-unquote liberal by any stretch. Especially history professors who thought that world civilization began with Rome. You can't get no more white and furious than that. But I digress. So we're going to get into it in just a little bit, but I want to get some people in quickly, Rose, so I'll get them and then I'll go to that.
Okay. All right.
Good morning, Ms. Faye.
Good morning. How are you doing this morning?
I'm doing well, Ms. Faye. Thank you for calling.
Very good. I just want to say that some people, they got the wrong understanding of everything. And as long as the vaccine has been out, and you can see that vaccine is helping. And it's really helping the older seniors that have pre-existing diseases and everything. And when they get the COVID, the COVID is light on them. And sometimes when you, they got confusion now about what bill they're going to pass and how they're going to pass it. Because I remember that Trump was a spender and the conservatives went along with him. Because when you know your own rules and regulations and you've been in politics so long and you let this dumb person come in, take over, tell you what he gonna do and what he not gonna do, and then we spend more money on this man because he got the Mar-a-Lago, whatever it is, in Florida. He spent more time on vacation than the golf course, and they never said anything to him about that. But they always accused President Obama is going on the golf course and all that kind of stuff, which was not true. Now, he played golf, but not every day or every week, and he's going to Mar-a-Lago or whatever that
Mar-a-Lago
hotel he's got.
Yeah.
Yes. And then he spent more money, and now that we need serious things done to our infrastructure and everything, and they're going to say, well, he's spending too much money. That's why we couldn't get anything done, because one thing, if you get things done when it is needed, maybe you can save some money on the long run.
Amen to that.
And then he took back money from the services, and they didn't say anything about that. And everybody else couldn't even touch it.
All right, Miss Faye, got to move on. Appreciate it, dog. Good morning, Bobby.
Good morning, Riff. How you doing?
Doing well, sir.
Man, you almost got that cookie, Riff. Well, you almost got that cookie earlier.
I can't close.
I'm gonna have my grandma make you a buttermilk pie, man, because you can't close.
Oh, man.
Whoa. What's in a buttermilk pie besides buttermilk?
Sugar?
Rip, I don't know, because I'd be lying to you if I try to tell you. All I know is just a good pie, man.
So it's like a cream brulee? Is it like a cream brulee?
Kind of.
Huh?
It's like a chest pie.
So
I mean, what's got
it's like a custard.
It's like a custard. Well, it's got to it's got to have a good crust, huh?
Oh, very good crust to it, man. It just melts. It just, I can't really describe it, but it just melts just in your mouth, mm-hmm. man. It's just so.
So, do you like buttermilk?
Good. No, she fixed it about 2 years ago, and she just tried it and said, you'll like it, and I tasted it with some coffee, and I've been fell in love with it ever since, man. Right. I asked, I'm like, dang, Grandma, why you ain't been making this pie right here?
So do you like buttermilk, bro?
No, I like buttermilk pie.
I used to see people all the time drink buttermilk and cornbread or buttermilk. And sometimes they put a little sugar in it. The Mac Browns will put a little sugar in it. But I could not. And I do like, I mean, it was a time I didn't like blue cheese and all, but I really love stinky cheese and blue cheese. But I just can't bring myself to drink buttermilk.
My grandma used to drink that buttermilk. I ain't understand why people drink it. Now, that's just going too far with it. But she still drink it, too.
Yeah. So, I'd like to try buttermilk pie. I want you to know, I like things that's made with buttermilk. There's no doubt about that.
Yeah, it's a very good pie, man. It's a very good pie. But I'm going to have to see if I can hook you up there,
man. Me too.
Yeah.
Me too, though.
When I get back in town, so I'm going to be out of the country for a few days, but definitely got to do that for you.
All right. Look forward to it.
Rip, I got a question, and then I'm going to let you go. Mm-hmm. How can people get locked up for SBA loans and PPP loans? But here in Alabama, they try to take the COVID relief money to build prisons.
How can they get locked up?
I'm kind of confused on that one.
Well, you do understand that, you know, just about any and everything can qualify for the CARES Act money. Literally. Everything can be said it's motivated because of COVID. We need more prisons because the prisons we have are not adequate to the quarantine. They can put literally anything under that. But now, how someone gets locked up for fraud is pretty easy. I mean, if you go in and you get, the money.
Yeah, but would that won't be fraud if you already, if you just taking relief money to keep your business going, then take the relief money to build another business. To me, that's like, it's like you trying to take the money to build a business.
Well, it's not a business. I mean, if the state is building it, it's a state it's a state prison. I mean, it's not a business. It's not a for-profit prison. That'd be a different story altogether.
That's money that they could have gave to the people. They could have gave that to the healthcare worker. They could have did a lot more with $400 million than just to build a prison.
Yeah, I saw Ivy come up with that idea. Let me just tell you, the states have more money than they know what to do with. This state has well over $1 billion, and they're trying to figure out how to spend it. Just this county, Harrison County, has $40 million. They're trying to figure out what to do with all this money. There's more money out here than can shake a stick at. I'm of the opinion that every so-called conservative state need to send that money back because obviously they don't need it. It shouldn't be in a rainy day fund. You got me.
Don't they take the money back then if they don't use it?
Well, that's a good question. Typically, when you're dealing with block grant money and other monies that's earmarked or allocated, they will take it back if the states don't use it. Now, the CARES Act money, I don't know what the time limit is on that. If it is a time limit, it has to be relevant to the fact that we're still in the middle of COVID.
Well, let me ask you one more question. I'm going to let you go. So the people if you got a prison or routed in the county that you live in, do they count the inmates that's in that prison to get more money for that county?
Yes.
They
do.
Oh, they do?
Yes. Everything is relevant to the number of inmates, the number of college students, the number of high school students. That's why you do a census. Everything is relevant based upon the number of people who are
there. Even though they locked up, they still use them as a census?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay.
Oh, absolutely.
Okay.
Positively, yeah. They're still, and actually, they could actually still be counted as voters in a certain area. Just because you're locked up doesn't mean you can't absentee vote. I mean, disqualification. I mean, there are some laws that's being challenged right now by the Center for Justice regarding that. I think ACLU maybe as well. That says that, you know, just because you're locked up, or even if you're a convicted felon, you do your time, you should be able to should be able to vote. Now, they stopped short of saying people who are, have been accused and are convicted of murder or rape. But I think even that, just if you do your time and you rape someone or murder, then you still should have, should never lose your right to vote, in my view. That should never be part of the punishment. Being locked up is your punishment. Losing your privileges to vote should never be. Now, there could be some argument about losing your right to keep and bear arms. That might be an argument. But once you've served your time, you should even be able to get your gun back, as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah, that's what I'm fighting for now, trying to help people get the gun rights and some of their rights. Like, well, if I definitely show, be tuning in next week when I get back. All right,
have a good one. All right, 228-896-9455. I want you to listen to this story here. I think it was done, LOX did this story locally regarding Ocean Springs, which used to be a very, very, quote-unquote, liberal, artistic place. And I don't know, since the last couple of elections, it seemingly has become more of what I would call draconian conservative in some areas. Hopefully that's going to change now that Shay Dobson is no longer the mayor. But there were some parents that showed up to argue, and you're seeing this more and more. Once it's about critical race theory, the others is about the schools are now teaching your children to be to go along, to get along, and not feel good about themselves. Even Tennessee passed a law that says that the teachers are not allowed to teach curriculums that make students feel discomfort. I'll show you that in a little bit, but first to Ocean Springs.
Parents in the Ocean Springs School District taking a deeper look into what their children are being taught and why. This all unveiled at today's special board meeting, and our Brandy McGill was there, and she explains why some parents and some board members have concerns.
Every opportunity that they have to insert some political type agenda, they do, and it's never the conservative view.
Board member Casey Waters and many parents believe the school district's curriculum software that's being purchased is just too political for school-age children.
If it was reversed, if it was a conservative point of view, it would have been pulled immediately. But because it's the liberal side or whatever, it's accepted and we can't go against it. That's unfair. Because if one thing's taught, teach the other also, or don't teach any of it.
Ocean Springs School District board members discuss Wednesday what should and should not be taught within the school district's classrooms. The software programs like Nearpod include more than just regular math and English lessons. They also include social and emotional learning lessons.
We put a lot of trust in Ocean Springs educators, and I love the teachers that we have in this district. And I know they really try to pick fair curriculum. But what they have to choose from is very slanted.
There are videos on gender. The titles of some of those videos are, there's more to gender than just boy and girl. Pronouns, and what do they mean? And this is not in the ELA section. This is in the other section.
Despite the concern expressed, the board approved in a 3-2 vote to fund all three curriculum software, Nearpod, MobiMax, and BrainPop. Ocean Springs School District Superintendent Dr. Benita Coleman says sections of the software, like the social and emotional learning lessons, can be censored, and in the district's trials over the summer had already been turned off.
It was truly eye-opening. I'm not going to lie, it even made me a little emotional. Things were talked about that I don't even agree with, but how it was handled and how well it was thought and researched, and I appreciate it. I had to go up and shake their hands. I just appreciate it.
In Ocean Springs, Brandy McGill, WLOX News Now.
Good story, Brandy. And we had an opportunity to just kind of scan some of those curriculum. And, I think it's long past time that teachers get out of the babysitting business. However, it's unfortunate that parents want teachers in the babysitting business now. It is very unfortunate. They are forced to do that. And look, I empathize with teachers that, and they will tell you right off the bat that there are students who come to schools who don't eat unless the school is open. Or there are students who come to school with very poor hygiene. And I'm not just talking one or two. I mean, there are teachers who will tell you that there are students who will tell them that they didn't sleep last night and probably didn't. Because of whatever reason, there is no curfew, there is no nap time or And so the teachers, in many cases, are forced to deal with those kinds of behavior. Now, all that said, I think that they are not equipped, in my view, to deal with some of the social or emotional things. And I didn't see that. The superintendent indicated that the curriculum can, in fact, be tailored. And it is. I don't know which parts of it is taught, which parts of it is not. I think as far as teaching students the proper use of pronouns, I think it's reasonable. Now, the idea that they don't teach boy and girl, just boy and girl, is not unusual. The point here is what they teach is good manners. And I don't know why we have stopped seeing that altogether. You know, there's no such thing as good manners. What is good manners? Well, you refer to someone the way they want you to refer to them. You know, Roe showed me this thing that nowadays when you put out some kind of bio or LinkedIn or something, you actually put your name and then what pronouns people could use mm-hmm. under your name?
Your preferred pronouns. Right. So mine would read Roe Evans, he, him, his.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
So you can actually choose. I mean, you can mm-hmm. choose her.
Or they.
Or they.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think personally, it's ridiculous, but the manners, good manners in me says if someone wants me to refer to them as they, I'm cool. I'm capable of doing that and showing doing it with respect. I really am. And I think if before you had this curriculum, I think that what the schools are doing now are coming up with eggheads who are trying, and I mean eggheads, these are the folks who start curricula like this, who, in an effort to try to come up with some universal way to have teachers teach. You know, that's what, and it's not the teachers now. These are the administrators. These are the folks, in many cases, who are not in the classroom. They're getting some impressions from the teachers. But these are the folks who say, we've got to stay on the same page. We want to have some continuity with how you handle a situation when it comes to Bobby. Hmm. Noting that Bobby is different from every other child in the classroom. But we've got to have one-size-fits-all kinds of schooling here, right? Instead of, in my view, just teaching a child to do unto others as you'd have them do unto you. Or have manners. It's not good manners, period. You know, you don't laugh at someone else's misfortune. You just don't. You know, and if you poke fun, then you will be punished. You know, for whatever reason, whatever you say, if you're poking fun, then you're going to be punished. I mean, and that was the general rule. That it was a clear line between what is adult, what is child, right? You're an adult, that's a child, and your job is to instruct them. You're not going to necessarily help them on their merry way emotionally or otherwise. You can't get that deep. You got the next period. Now, granted, teachers might get caught up. I know, got you. So if you get caught up like that, and there's an emotional situation, just as you are required to contact law enforcement if you see a whelp on a child's leg, you should be required to call mama or daddy to ask them.
I can't talk to my parents about my sexual situation, but I can talk to you, teacher.
Well, you can let them talk. And immediately thereafter, call their mama and daddy. Say, hey, look. Here's what your child told me.
Wait a minute. Are you saying that should be required?
Absolutely.
Why?
What do you mean, why? It should be required to inform. Now, one thing, if in fact the child is saying that the daddy molested her or him, then you call the law enforcement. Because they are required to, by law, to report that.
Right. So you would apply that to any kind of abuse. If this is like a gay student.
Oh, absolutely.
And the parent, okay.
Oh, right. Absolutely.
I got you.
Absolutely. I think that the first order of business, they still have a parent, and that parent has to be the person to handle such things as that.
Agreed.
Right?
Just to keep the school completely out of that business, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, the point is just adult to adult.
Yeah, okay.
Just adult to adult. There used to be some solidarity, but now, unfortunately, there are some adults who are too busy trying to act like children, too busy trying to win the trust of the child rather than do the trust that's required by adults, right? So, look, I don't know how the curriculum is being applied. I think the superintendent is excellent. I do. I think you've got a very good one. I think that the idea that there is a curriculum that is inclusive is extraordinary. I think it makes good sense. It makes good sense. Now, however, all that said, this obligation to have one size fit all students is ridiculous. I think that we're trying to apply too much academics to what I consider as common sense and the simple socialization skills earned by children. Children are going to be cruel to each other. They're going to laugh. They're going to talk. They're going to bully. This is what they do. You know, I shared with my daughter just last night. You know, she had a situation with my grandson. And my grandson had shared with her that he didn't like a certain individual, a male, who was coming on. And he generalized and said he didn't like people like that. And so she, you know, her reaction, because he's a bigger individual, was, you know, okay, we're going to go ahead and get it all straight. To which I said, no. You either ask him, so how are you going to handle it? And what is it the person is doing to you, and why is it you don't like it? And then ask him, this is the same child, actually, who had COVID. How are you going to handle it? And let that boy develop some socialization skills. It's not just, hey, mama, what you going to do to help me? And this is what I find a lot with single parent, mother head of households, of which she is, and I love her. She's doing an excellent job overall. You've got to let them learn how to socialize with other children, whatever the dynamic. It could be bullying. It could be anything. It can be that they love someone that doesn't like them, because children are going to go through this. And first and foremost, you should ask, well, so what is your response to them when they do that? Well, here's my response. Is that effective? You know, in other words, you, instead of rushing in to put mom against another child, you've got to allow them to adjust to a situation. There are sometimes when they need to run, avoid a situation. Or sometimes when you've got to say, well, all right, you know, this person has every right to say what he wants and call you whatever name he wants. It's his mouth. Now you got to learn how to handle that, or come back with a better name for him, right? Or, you know, avoid a situation altogether. But it's just the helicopter mom syndrome, I think, exists, particularly when you have a mother head of household and a son. Mm-hmm. You know, as a man, you know, I was expected to handle that. And my dad would say, okay, well, so what you going to do? How you going to handle it? I know one thing, you better not get kicked out of school, and you better not bring home less than an A or B. I don't want to see too many B's either. That's what he's going to tell me. So I really think that, although I don't know all the details of how they're giving this instruction to the person who asked me to talk about it, I think that actually the teachers need to take a greater hand in actually the curriculum writing. I think what you have here is psychiatrists, children psychiatrists and counselors, and some of which have never been in a damn classroom, who are going to instruct teachers how to handle socialization and or emotional situations for Bobby in their classroom. And I think it's dumb. I really do. Now, look, you've got it. I know. Not that I'm criticizing. I'm telling you now, I'm not. However, I think teachers, real teachers, are far better equipped with, first and foremost, teaching their class. Secondly, how to handle a situation that is the socialization within the classroom. Outside the classroom, you call it mama. You got me, bro?
Yeah.
I mean, that's exactly how, in my day, it was managed. You know, if in fact there was a situation involving a young girl in seventh grade who was crying all the time, to which the teacher, Miss Crewell, I know, bless her heart, she's still with us, I love her. You know, we left the class and she had a conversation. I don't know what it was about, but I do know this, her mother came to the class. You know, and by the time lunch was over here, her mother had taken her and she'd gone. It's like, okay, well, this is something that, you know, you include the parent with and let them handle it. Unfortunately, I think, you know, some teachers feel that they just cannot call the parent because the parent doesn't respond or because the parent is, could be part of the problem. Well, in that case, and you got to call DHS.
Yeah.
And I think the principal needs to take that. In other words, if you've got a child who's coming there unprepared and malnourished and lack of sleep, or for that matter, a child who comes there smelling like reefer, you got to report that.
Yeah, I mean that's you got to look out for the well-being of the child first and foremost.
Yeah, I mean just, and by the way, they are compelled to report if in fact they have some signs of abuse.
Yes.
If they don't report it, they can be criminally charged.
Yes,
but I also think that teachers and or administrators should be held responsible, not necessarily criminally but civilly, if they do not contact the parent when there is some emotional situation going on with the child. Instead of trying to be a parent to the child, because you're not going to take that baby home. You'll go there, you might give some very good instructions, and then you're gone. You're going back to your wonderful house. This child's going back to that environment.
Mm.
So, I have a very serious problem with curriculum that allows teachers to become more counselors. Let the counselor do it. Let the teacher teach whatever they're teaching. If they're teaching math, stick to math. Well, stick to math and grammar, of course. I mean, just because you're teaching about numbers doesn't mean you allow someone to get away with improper grammar. I mean, that's unacceptable. Stop being a teacher.
But you would say, though, that the fair and correct teaching of history, you know, falls into the purview of the teacher, right?
Absolutely. Now, that's another story altogether. It really is. This whole... folks, look, there's no critical race theory being taught in any schools. That's an oxy-conservative way of trying to arouse bigots or arouse people who think they're not bigots and into reacting. Look, and I'm going to get into this now because I'm glad you went there. I want to go ahead and do this thing. I think Charlemagne did something on it this morning. This crazy mother who weighed in on critical race theory or her view of what critical race theory was and how she feels her child is being put upon. And I want you to just, I'm going to go ahead and just, do you have the whole thing?
Did you want the CNN story or the donkey story?
Yeah, let's go with the CNN story. The okay. CNN story on this Robert Steeman and how she reacted there. Where is this? Is it Tennessee? Where was she?
Yeah, Tennessee.
Yeah. To her thought that her child was being taught critical race theory. Here it is.
Just outside of Nashville, basic American history is up for debate.
His parents taught him about George Washington, and he identifies George Washington as a white man, and then asks if he would be killed back then because he has brown skin. I mean, he's judging George Washington not by any of what he, about being the founder of our country.
So when do we tell the kid that, in fact, he may have been killed back then because of the color of his skin?
I'm not sure that's what you teach, that you would have been killed for the color of your skin. That's a narrative, really. That's
Robin Steeman is trying to change the narrative on race in the Williamson County, Tennessee public school district. She pulled her child out of public school, and now she leads a chapter of Moms for Liberty in this wealthy, Republican-leaning suburb. Nationally, the group is known for loudly protesting school masking.
And it has traumatized Williamson County kids.
But Steenman's chapter filed a different kind of complaint with the Tennessee Department of Education this summer.
Because it's historically accurate, it's appropriate for a 6-, 7-, 8-year-old.
Moms for Liberty is angry about an inclusion curriculum being taught in the county public schools. They're mostly concerned about 4 books being taught in second grade. One tells a story of school segregation through the eyes of Mexican-American students. One is about the March on Washington. And 2 are about civil rights icon Ruby Bridges.
I'll show you in the teacher's manual. It instructs the teacher to point this word out and teach about racial slurs. And how
Steeman says it's okay for kids to read the book Bridges wrote about her experience as a 6-year-old. But it's not okay for kids to talk about some of the pictures in the book, like Norman Rockwell's famous painting.
All this curriculum highlights is the mean white people and how she's victimized, and it speaks to nothing of the good.
Educators across the country are alarmed by talk like this.
We see some sort of almost manufactured crisis here. There isn't a crisis in how we teach history in this country. You would never go into a school in Germany and say, oh, why do you teach about Nazism? You would never ask that question, because they do teach about it, because teachers want kids in Germany to understand what that history was.
The Moms for Liberty complaint says students are being taught lessons that have anti-American, anti-white, and anti-Mexican teaching. And state law may be on their side.
We will not be teaching critical race theory in Tennessee.
In May, the governor signed HB 580 into law. It bans lesson plans that make students, quote, feel discomfort, guilt, or anguish because of their race. Moms for Liberty says the new rules mean separate is never equal. A picture book about the California schools in the 1940s should be banned because it makes both white and Hispanic kids feel bad.
The ones where it looks like the Mexican children are behind bars and it says no.
That surprises the book's author.
The villain here is racism, is segregation. And at the end of the book, what I wanted to show is the Mexican-American children and the white children being in school together and playing together and interacting with each other.
These conversations about the past are very relevant, other moms in the community say.
My son had an incident at his middle school that was where students locked arms, and if you were white, they would break the arms to let kids go through. If you were black, they kept their hands together and told you that you needed to go back to Mexico.
They said they were building a wall.
They were building a wall.
Public school moms Ravita Rahman and Jennifer Cortez founded the group One Wilco after a series of racial incidents rocked the district.
What's concerning about the law, it's not inclusive of everybody. I don't think it's divisive talking about these uncomfortable topics.
They're bullying our school board. They're bullying our elected officials.
The school board told CNN it's reviewing the books cited in the complaint.
What would it mean for education if books like Separate is Never Equal were pulled off the shelves by these laws that we're seeing spread up across the country?
Well, I think we're entering toward a pretty scary time if we're talking about politicians banning books. I thought we were long past those days. Educators know how to talk about race with kids in an age-appropriate way. These conversations can be had, and in a way that is in keeping with our core values as Americans.
Evan McMorris Santoro, CNN, Williamson County, Tennessee.
Hang on, we'll be back.
Stand for him. It's a new day with Rip Daniels, the number one talk show in South Mississippi, on Jay-Z 94.5.
Shaka Khan, Shaka Khan. All right, folks, good morning to you. Rip Daniels here. Thank you for joining us. Show is called It's a New Day. Only one rule, no such thing as a right or wrong opinion. Good morning, Cincinnati, Ohio. Appreciate you tuning us in. Hang on, you guys, on the phone, because I really want to get into this, and hopefully we'll help somebody along the merry way to understand what they are and what they're doing regarding this critical race theory thing and the fact that in some cases you may be a bigot. First, the invention of racial bigotry, Caucasian racial bigotry to be more precise, is all born and forwarded by false narrative. See, there is a false narrative which results in a false equivalent. There is absolutely nothing in American history that is just like enslavement, and nothing just like the enslavement of African Americans. And there are those who will put forward a narrative, and bigots actually, that there is something like it, right? On the one hand, they'll say it's in the, you know, they are against enslavement, but as always, this big but, what about this? They have to search for a false equivalent. And in this case, when the so-called critical race theory is put forward only by oxy-conservative talk radio, nobody else is talking about this because nobody else even know about it. And if it is a curriculum, it's somewhere in college, probably somewhere like Oxford. I mean, my first time hearing it was from some oxy-conservative nut job on one of the news shows. I mean, what is that? I should know about that, critical race theory.
Right.
I don't know anything about it. You know, however, now that's become the drumbeat to assist women like this Robin Stinneman and the Liberty, the Moms for Liberty. They now have a cause. Before, they were rebels without a cause, and that's exactly what conservative talk does. It creates a cause. Here's a cause. We're going to save you from them. They want to come in and take your guns. They want to come in and take your daughters. They want to come in and take your way of life. And there are those who listen only to that, and they become indoctrinated with that. And then they come out into the world in the school board thinking, okay, yeah, I'm defending. Oh, look at me, look at me. I'm now going to defend you. You are the enemy. You are the leftist. You are the liberal. You're not an American. Without really understanding the very history of people who are talking just like them. She's talking just like a segregationist.
Mm-hmm.
But she doesn't want her child to learn about segregationists. They didn't want to learn that. I mean, when you start talking about little bridges there over in Louisiana, that Norman Rockwell painting of her being escorted by marshals, you know, the idea that they were all Caucasians, adults screaming and wanting her blood is fact. But here is what they are not taught. Here is what the white bigots, end quote, are not wanting their children to be taught. They are not wanting their children to be taught about over half of the Freedom Riders were white. Over 250,000 white men and boys came to the South to fight against other white men and boys. The fact of the complexion is irrelevant to this. It is their belief. They don't want their children to learn about that. They don't want them to learn about the Quakers. They don't want them to learn about the thousands of Bostonians who refused to allow an African American to be taken back into enslavement. They don't want that. You see, what happens with the bigot is the only thing he or she has got going for them is the protection of that thin organ called skin. That's it. Their pale complexion is the most they've got going for them. And they feel that's the most that their child has got going for them. You're white, and that means something, as per Rush Limbaugh. So when you hear this teacher say, well, okay, George Washington was white, and he was an enslaver, one of the largest. And actually, upon his death, he had bequeathed that those enslaved would be freed. Well, Martha said, "Now y'all ain't going nowhere." No, it's a true story. I'm not making it up. And the mere fact that if he were African-American, he would not have been president, that's for sure, and he could have been killed, is something that every Caucasian needs to understand, but not because he was, quote-unquote, white, but because of the wretchedness of the conservatives who didn't allow African Americans to be president. And see how I did that? See, it's not about black and white in my country. It's about wherever you have the person who takes the conservative view. And the conservative view is, I'm conserving what is real Americans to just me. I conserve this. I'm divvying out America. I'm divvying out rights. I'll divvy out rights to the blacks. I'll divvy out rights to the women. I'll divvy out rights to the gays. I conserve this. The Constitution is as per what I say it is. That is the conservative mindset. I challenge one of you to call me. Let's have the debate. Go get you, call one of these guys at USM or over at JD. Get your professor to call. I challenge that. Because trust me on this. There is plenty of history to show exactly what I'm talking about going back to South Carolina. And Calhoun. Even before then. So there is a false narrative and they seek to get a false equivalent. Well, you see, segregation, here's their equivalent to segregation or the deprivation of civil rights. You gotta wear a mask. I gotta wear a mask. Martin Luther King said, you should be free to do whatever you want and consider the content of my character. That's what you should be doing. You got me? And right now, you hear them using Martin Luther King. They'll come up, they'll say it, Martin Luther King. But there is no equivalent. There is no equivalent to the conservative concept of segregation and or enslavement and or denying women the right to vote. Or any other people. There is no equivalent. I'll get to it. Trust me. And he'll go to the phones. There's no doubt about that.
Get the info. Stay informed. It's a new day with Rip Daniels. The number one talk show in South Mississippi on Jay-Z 94.5.
Think I'll ever need you, love, more than you need me. Show me your true colors, girl, I just wanna see. Cause I done had too many come around and change on me. She's screaming, please don't waste my time. I say I totally agree.
See, girl, I'm fine with that. I done gave my watches away, ain't got no time for that. Asking where's my heart, good luck finding that. How long could I see her around? Think I'm still timing that.
All right, folks, good morning to you. Rip Daniels here. Thank you for joining us. The show is called It's a New Day. There's only one rule. There's no such thing as right or wrong opinion here, folks. Just bear with me here because it's, you know, I think that we are at a precipice in our country whereby the division as promoted by conservatism has now become so fluid that it is starting to harden like water, freezing. And there are some who are literally stuck, bro. They are literally stuck in a mindset that is as virtual and as phony as a video game. They are literally fighting against the invisible so-called liberal, leftist, whatever enemy, and the enemy is actually within.
So this is a a straw man, fake.
There's no doubt it's a straw
boogeyman.
Oh, absolutely. And that's exactly what has happened with particularly Caucasian bigotry since the beginning of this country, but especially with the Confederacy. There's always this what if, okay, first they do this, then they do that. The great fear was promoted long before this country was a country, actually going back to the 1600s, which is why the 1619 Project is so significant. And it was when actually the governor there in Massachusetts and in Virginia came up with the bright idea of skin privilege, which separated the indentured servants from those who were enslaved. Lemuel Haynes, the person I talked about, the Revolutionary War hero, was a mulatto, and his mama was from Scotland, and his daddy was African. That was very, very prevalent in the beginning stages of this country, and of course, you can't teach that, because that's critical race theory in the minds of some, amalgamation. But that's how it was. This country has always been multiracial, always. Because, you had people of Asian descent and African descent here in this country, to be quite frank, when Columbus ventured across the Atlantic. But that questions whether or not, you know, the entire world and whatever discoveries was a white man's thing. I mean, that's why you have, the three percenters, with this illusion that somehow the only 3% of Americans fought for this country and none of them look like me. And that's just a lie. Mm. At least 5,000 were inducted into the Revolutionary Army.
Well, the very first one to be in the fight.
Yeah, and that's not to count the Minutemen. But I digress. The thing you've got to grasp, if you are in fact wondering whether you're a Caucasian bigot, is why do you search for a comparison? What is just like being black? No, really. I can tell you, if you were to ask me what's just like being black, being white. Oh, absolutely. There really is no, it's no difference. I mean, you just happen to have a Caucasian complexion. I know African Americans who are as white as some white people. There's no difference. That's a minor organ. There's nothing just like, in other words, when you ask me what's just like being black, my position is, well, yeah, there's not this long list, but you ask a bigot what's just like being black, he will never say himself. Can't do it. Because all he's got going for him is that he's white and his perception of what white is. And that's why James Baldwin said that white and black are political designations, and they are.
So the distance between the two will continue to be reinforced by those who are brought up in that ideology, because that's a key part, if not the biggest part, of their identity.
Yeah. You see, as long as he identifies himself as white, I got to be something else.
Right.
You got me? We can't just all be Americans, because he's got to be white. And and that is an invention, I don't mind telling you. It's a European invention. In many cases, goes back to when the Moors invaded Southern Europe. The Moors? Yeah, right. You know, not the Moors in Boston jail right now, but the Moors coming out of the Middle East and going across Northern Africa and invading Europe and defeating the Europeans. Spanish, Portuguese, the French. And occupying Italy and everything else there for well over a century. Now, I guess that would be critical race theory to teach that to Caucasian students, because after all, surely they can't believe that that actually black men were actually in Europe. Of course, that really helped that olive complexion in and around Spain and Italy now, didn't it? You know, so. When you talk to an individual like that and they feel they've got to do the comparison, they might say, "Oh yeah, well, you know, I'm really against slavery." But that's when you know what you're dealing with. There's no buts. There's no reasonable explanation. There is no equivalent that Negroes did to white people, in quotes. There's no equivalent to when it comes to segregation, that what Negroes, black people, did to white people. A bigot thinks there is. And he based it on a false narrative, and which results in a false equivalent. There's no comparison. And rather than realizing that and realizing the dastardly deeds of people who look like him, but at the same token, accepting that there were people who looked like him who fought against people who had those dastardly deeds. He cannot bring himself to celebrate Lauza, the female who was killed on her way to Montgomery after Selma, Bloody Sunday. He cannot bring himself to celebrate the Jewish rabbi in Jackson, whose synagogue was bombed. And he was very outspoken about segregation. Or to bring it closer to home, he cannot bring himself to celebrate right here on the coast Knox Walker, the white lawyer who defended Dr. Mason, Dr. Dunn, and was threatened often. Or Father McClune, who was the priest, like Scotch too, by the way, who was part of the same group that was fighting for civil rights. Can't bring himself.
That was Dr. Perry Nussbaum up in Jackson.
Yeah.
They can't bring themselves to celebrate the white people who actually was on the right side of history and celebrate the creed of this great country. However, they need to be taught about them, because then they will understand that when you teach the history of those who were Caucasian, who acted the opposite, they will learn that, okay, you know what? There were white people who acted right. And it ain't about whether you're white. It's about whether you are right. We'll be back.
WJZD FM Long Beach, Bay St. Louis, Wiggins, Moss Point, the all-new JZ 94.5.
Time for jazz at level. That song made its way around. It did not hit the soul charts per se, but it was certainly all over the jazz charts and made its way into the club in a very, very big way. But it mostly made its way into the bedroom. Ain't no hearing the buzz about that. It's a long song too.
Big way.
Yeah, it's a very. The whole side of the album is that, isn't
it? It's a 10-minute song.
Ooh, 10 long minutes. Mm. All right, little jazzmatazz. Keep on playing. Trust me on this. Yes, and there's an art in noise. See how I did that? All right, 228-896-9455. That's the number to call the show. It's called It's a New Day. One rule, no such thing as a right or wrong opinion. Looks like we do. The funding for the government has been passed. However, the Democrats are doing what Democrats do because they have a big tent, and that is argue with each other. They are holding up the infrastructure bill in many ways. Two of the Democrats are doing that. And you know what, folks? I would hope that only the Republican Party would do the same. They did do it when it came down to Donald John, especially Liz Cheney. You know, I hate this idea that you have more allegiance to the party than to your constituents. And Mnuchin has the allegiance to his constituents in as much as he realizes that if he doesn't act like so-called conservatives, then he will not get elected. We'll get to that in a minute. I want to go to, is it Hassan? Hang on. Yeah, Hassan. Hassan, good morning. How are you?
How you doing?
Doing well, sir.
All right. Yeah, listen, I was just listening to your Jazz at 11, that song. It came out back in 85.
Yeah.
The first time that song was played was on, with that I remember was on Miami Vice doing a love scene. And it just became popular after that. And I remember buying that cassette just for that song only.
Miami Vice, you're exactly right, my friend. Miami Vice was it was hot, brother. Miami Vice, yeah.
That's the first time I heard that song. But listen, I wanted to ask you about the guy, the young guy up there in Pontotoc County.
Yeah.
Now I noticed that the mother had said that she wished her son would have gotten the vaccine. You know, Rip, I hear this a lot. Every time there's a death. Whenever it hits home to someone, they say, I wish he'd have got the vaccination. I wish they'd have got the vaccination. I mean, does someone always have to die or just get gravely ill before they say, okay, well, let's go ahead and just get this vaccine and maybe we can just stop this spread?
Yeah.
Does anybody ever think about that?
It's when I came on, I gave just a little simple survey and a reason for why I got vaccinated. And that was inside my circles, there are 10 people. Half of them got COVID, some seriously ill. I've not had a death yet. But that told me that if 10 people in my inner circle got COVID, there's a 50% chance that I'm going to get COVID, right? I think there still exists. It's not if I get it, it's when I get it. So in other words, people have to make that evaluation not based upon even a 16-year-old or what national numbers are, but just inside of their circles. If you can think of 10 people, 20 people who you know got COVID, even be it they survived it or not, then you've got to say to yourself, well, more than likely, if they got it and they're this close to me, I'm going to probably get it. And then do what is necessary to protect yourself. People have not made that decision, I think, because of not just only faulty information, but because up until now, they may not have been confronted with actual real people they knew who had it and were able to express it. I think it's going to change, though, Hassan. More people get it, and the more people, especially with children, the more people get it and know people who die or have a rough go of it, trust me, they're going to ask themselves whether they want to take that chance. Don't you?
Exactly.
How many people you know?
I think they will.
Yeah, how many people you know just know have it or have died from it?
I know a couple of people that have died from it. I have a relative, a distant relative, who's actually gravely ill right now in the unit in Ocean Springs Hospital, who has it. And the ironic thing about this, Rip, her brothers and sisters still will not get vaccinated. And yeah. Death is looking at them in right there in the front door.
Wow.
And it just really amazes me.
Well, it amazes me, too. But they, like
and
I said.
50% of my... All my brothers, all except for one of my brothers and sisters have had it.
Is that so, right? But you're vaccinated, though?
Hassan? Yes, sir. Yes, yeah. Sir. I took the Moderna.
Yeah. All right. Well, good for you. Appreciate you being with us. It's just another line of defense. It really is, folks. I don't, you know, I don't see it any more than that. It's another line of defense. You know, I mean, it's you decide how sick you want to be. Or you take the chance. I mean, it's a 50-50 chance. I got it. Just roll the dice. No big deal. But the problem we have here is that we'll continue vacillating over this if, in fact, we don't stop to spray it. You know what I mean? We're going to be going with this forever. You know what I mean? Because somebody feels, okay, I don't have to. And if it comes down to forced quarantine, and it can, like what happened with tuberculosis, then, you know, so be it. But, you know, we're making it extraordinarily difficult.
And what I'm not, because, I mean, you just mentioned that, what I don't get is this full outrage now before there is a forced quarantine. I mean, I could see if people get pissed off at that point, you know, your rights are being infringed upon. You're right. But it's for the rights and the health and the greater well-being of the greater good, the needs of the many, et cetera, et cetera. Right. So I am just kind of befuddled with the notion that these folks are this upset about wearing a mask, being asked if you've been vaccinated, showing that you have tested negative for COVID-19, when there's nothing that's really been taken from you at this point, unless you live in New York. And even then, you're given an option. It's not being talked about nearly enough.
228-896-9455. Johnny, good morning. How are you? Thank you for being patient, bro.
Good morning, Riff. How you doing today?
I'm doing well, man. Doing well.
Yeah, you know, I don't want to seem crass or rude, but you know, I just don't even want to talk about people who refuse to take the vaccine at this point because you're doing it to yourself. And, you know, you have to love yourself. You have to love your country. You got to love your community.
Yeah.
And you don't have a country if you don't have people. You don't have a community if you don't have family. So, there, I said it. Mm-hmm. I'm just befuddled. You know, I went to school in Mississippi. I lived there for a while. I moved away. You know, better opportunities, better employment, better economic outlook. Yeah, but, you know, at some point in time, I just have to wonder, you know, every other state, you know, when it comes to, like, sociology reports, you hear the report from Yale or Harvard on what's going on in the community as far as with, you know, diseases and lifestyle and all this stuff. How come we have not heard anything from the economic professors at Alcorn and Jackson about how this infrastructure bill is going to positively impact the life and livelihood of families and business in Mississippi? How come?
That's a very good question.
I think, this is my opinion,
mm-hmm.
but it's past time for a stadium to be built on the Gulf Coast because they don't have a neutral stadium in the state of Mississippi other than in Jackson, and they want to tear that down to expand the hospital. So it's time to build a stadium on the Gulf Coast so that, you know, all of the colleges can have games because you can have more opportunity. That's jobs. You can't do anything about crime if you don't have jobs. So, you know, Texas is one of those states, yeah, it's Republican and they do all this stuff, but that's just on the surface level. They make the news and do on Fox with all the stuff they do in Texas, but they do a lot of Democratic things here.
Yeah.
So, other than, you know, Arkansas and Louisiana, you know, Mississippi, Arkansas, and Louisiana are fighting to be at the bottom when it comes to infrastructure and construction and jobs. So, you know, I would like to know, you know, what is the economy like in Mississippi? What needs to be done to fix it? And how come we haven't heard anything from the economics professors at the university on how this could impact, you know, business lives, livelihood, because everybody, any entrepreneur is listening to your show, wants to know where the next opportunity is so they can make some money.
Right.
And I just want to know,
well,
what do we have to do to get the information?
You got to get rid of conservatives. I'm going to tell you, a conservative is another name for good old boys. They are still running Mississippi. I'm going to tell you that.
Well, and you say that, and I found this out. So, you know, a lot of your small towns in Mississippi that are underdeveloped that would actually benefit from this bill.
Right.
They don't even have state pension funds or state employees. The county gets the money from the state, and they have the city in the catch-22 to where the city can't grow because they don't have the money.
Right.
So, you know, this infrastructure bill kind of cuts through that. And I think that's why the Republicans don't want the money to come in, because they're having their field day by keeping everybody stuck. But I just think, you know, it's time for, you know, to discuss this.
Yeah.
But I don't think people really know how it's going to impact them.
Well,
even though we just went through the pandemic and the kids had to do homeschool and the internet was slow, they still don't get it.
Yeah. You know, and of course, this is really even more, what makes it more striking is the fact we just had a little bridge to collapse right there, I think, in George County, killing two or three people and injuring several more during the hurricane. I know you may have seen that washout. There's infrastructure bill. You've got $110 billion for roads and bridges that would go toward that.
But it's past that, because remember when Obama tried to pass the Affordable Care Act, they were going to invest money in the hospital.
Right.
What did Republicans say? No.
Right.
Now that the pandemic and all the hospitals full, now you wish you had the money, all those states that turned out of money. Right. Now here we come in with an infrastructure bill that's going to fix roads and bridges and clean water and everything else.
Right.
And you still against it. I mean...
Well, you got to understand the feudal system.
Alive,
Johnny,
you don't want the vaccine.
You got to understand the feudal system. The feudal system, going back to plantations, is that you keep the very rich and the very poor. And what is pivotal and important to the very rich, the plantation system, the feudal system, is that you have cheap labor. And that is exactly why Mississippi did not have a public school system until after the Civil War, during Reconstruction. They still don't want to have it. But
do you have cheap labor or not? You still need the infrastructure bill so you can have some labor.
Well,
but I understand what you're saying. We don't want to underpay people. But, come on. At some point in time, pride in Mississippi has to come first. You can't be the bottom always.
It can't come first as long as you've got good old boys who realize that if it comes first, that means that they can then be done away with, gotten rid of. In other words, right. if in fact the peasants can one day become the king, then you realize the king is vulnerable. You can't allow that to happen, and that's what's happening. All of the federal dollars that come to this state goes through the filthy hands of good old boys, and that's the conservative individuals who are right now Dictator Reeves and Gunn and Debit Hoseman. And they're okay
but
with the money.
It's not just infrastructure in this bill. It's also money for your police and fire. I mean, y'all don't need new fire stations. You don't need more police. You don't need better facilities?
Absolutely. But here's the problem. And by the way, the first bill is a bipartisan bill. I want you to understand that. That is a bipartisan bill. That first $1 trillion, $1.2 trillion. The third one that has a significant amount of money, like what you're talking about, is for natural resources, goes to the Energy Committee. $198 billion goes to the Energy and Natural Resources Committee and so forth. And all of that is designed to develop other ways, solar and so forth, right here in this state. The point you're making is that the money will come here and be spent here and therefore create jobs here. Go ahead.
How does your city council or your mayor feel? I would like to know, what they're for. Yeah. I want to know how, because where else we going to go in the South on vacation? At some point in time, you're going to come to Gulfport.
Right.
So, other than going to the Almanet Hotel for those lollipop lamb chops that my wife loves so much, I want to know what else we can do, because what is city council, what's on their list?
Yeah.
What's on the mayor's list?
But I can tell you there have been some allocations just recently of some of the Tidelands money by the and I got to move on. I appreciate you being with us, Johnny, but... the Tidelands money was divvied out several million dollars, and not much of that went to, I can tell you, none of that went through some seriously depraved African-American areas. And I don't know if that was a great jumping up and down or argument coming out of the city council and or the cities themselves. Do you know that the only community right now that even applied for NITWIF grants and got NITWIF grants was the Turkey Creek community, thanks to one Derek Evans. $7 million came through the Turkey Creek watershed area. As the only African-American community, not only in Mississippi, but even in Louisiana. The NITWIF grants is the BP money. It's incredible. It wasn't applied for, wasn't sought out. And then you've got some nitwits who were fighting against the actual money coming here. and some of which were misled by some of the leadership on the city council, who are not explaining that, okay, hey, look, conservation and restoration has a purpose and has a process, and it should come first. But anyway, I think, Johnny, I really appreciate that. A lot of us don't know in this state, and some of us choose not to know, that what has held this state back has been the conservative mindset that they want to control. They want the federal dollars. Right now, Mississippi is sitting on a $1 billion rainy day fund. They're trying to figure out what to do with all the CARES money. But on the other hand, they're conservative and say, well, look, big government. On the other hand, they like taking that big government money. They're not going to send it back. And this from a state that has, that spends the least amount of money on children, and at the top of every bad list and bottom of every good list. I mean, have the poorest, the most unhealthy, the far less insured. It's incredible. But the conservative mindset has hindered, and that's why, when, ladies and gentlemen, I'm telling you, in this next election, what you've got to look for is, okay, when someone says that they are conservative, what they're saying is that they're with the good old boy system, and they're gonna place the blame, show the shame, and then pick your pocket, your federal pocket. That's your tax dollars here, folks. 228-896-9455. Oh, did I cut off Miss Faye? Hang on, Kurt and Cole. I'm gonna push Miss Faye back to the line. Good morning, Miss Faye.
Good morning. Yeah. I just wanted to say about this. The way they are going to give you out the money or whatever it is, they don't care whether the children are educated or not, because they want to decide what you can teach or whatever it is. But I want to see this one thing, and then I'm going to hang up.
Right.
Is that they always, big is always saying that they are put upon. Would they ever think about how we are put upon?
No.
They can't understand that they're doing the put upon, not us. We're trying to survive and do the best we can for our children, where they can get educated and they would accomplish something in their life. But all this put up on this, they should stop saying that, because I realize now that they are just they are stupid. And Trump asked the main question, how stupid are the American people? And they are showing anything that say that Trump is smart, he's a genius, and I want to give him something he didn't earn. Well, And that's all I'm going to say about it.
Thank you, ma'am. Appreciate it. Kurt, you're next. Good morning.
What's going on, Rip?
How you doing, brother?
Man, look, I just want to talk about the little vaccine for a minute. I just want to mention this real quick.
All right.
The thing about the vaccine, I'm probably gonna take it. Though I've been on the fence about it. You know, I know I had people close to me that had it, and you know they made it through or whatever. But you know, you got deaths with it. You know what I mean? When it come down to people taking the vaccine, some of them, you know, you got some that ain't, like, you know, people make it through the vaccine and all that. But my thing is this about it though. I'm going to probably take it because I want to keep my job. My job trying to mandate it or whatever. But what's up, all right, by the people who taking it, something happened to them. I heard it's a form you got to sign. I don't know if it's true or not. I'll see when I get there. But it's a form you got to sign that they're not responsible for whatever happened to you after taking this vaccine. I just want to know how you feel about that. And one more thing, if the COVID vaccine is not a cure, then why are they mandatory to take it? Now, I respect it all the way around to keep everybody from getting sick and all that, you know what I'm saying? But if it ain't a real cure for this thing, then it should be optional till they get it together. You know what I'm saying? Really optional. Don't be giving no ultimatum to keep the job or get fired, or, you know what I'm saying, or
Kurt,
whatever.
Yeah, Kurt, hang on. I don't want you to go anywhere, brother, because I feel your pain. I know, and I could tell that you're apprehensive about the vaccine. So was I. All right. I just took the vaccine, going back to July, I think. And there's nothing wrong with getting the information. You know, vaccines has never been well, I'm not going to say that, but let's just put it this way. The vaccine is designed to inoculate you. In other words, it is to give you some antibodies to help you fight against the disease. Like the vaccines you take for polio or the measles, right? It's designed to help to give you antibodies to resist your getting the disease. You can still get the disease. It's rare. So now, I don't know about this signing off on anything, but I can tell you that the Congress passed a law that says you cannot, that the pharmaceutical companies won't be held liable. And actually, I think there was something like that on the books before. But just to ease your mind, you're having to decide, you know, whether or not, you know, you will survive the disease if you get it, and how you will survive it. You know, it's rather than thinking that somehow or another the vaccine is the threat, you realize COVID is the threat. So now how are you going to fight it? So you ask yourself, well, how do I fight it? Wear a mask? You know, can I go on the job and keep others from giving it to me? You know, would it help me? I can tell you right now that people who have the vaccine have spent, let's put it this way, far less days in the hospital. I mean, most of those who are getting deathly ill right now did not have the vaccine. And you can't ignore that. So you need to ask yourself, would you be better to have it or not have it? It's as simple as that.
Yeah. Hey, look, I'm going to say one thing, and I'm going to let you go. My cousin in the healthcare field, a man told me, it stuck with me, man. He said, why chance it? You know, he said, go and get the vaccine, because one, if you catch it, and your immune system can't hold up to it, then you know what I'm saying? You're on your deathbed or whatever. He said, why chance it? Just go and get the vaccine. Yeah. You know what I mean? That stuck with me right there, you know?
All right, brother. Kurt, appreciate it here.
All right.
You're going to make the right decision. You know, folks, the only thing I could say is that, you know, what's your options? You know what I mean? You weigh your options. And look, if you look around you and you got COVID all around you, then, you know, whatever protection you can get, you need to get that. That means you got to go out of town until it's over. Go out of town. You know? You know, I kind of look at this, bro, like I look at a hurricane, a Category 4 or 5 hurricane out there in the Gulf of Mexico. I want to do everything that I can to protect myself.
Yeah. So you're going to go ahead and board up those windows, right?
I'm going to board up some windows, yeah. It's don't get me wrong. Boarding up the windows may not, in and by itself, stop. It ain't going to stop a tornado. It still can destroy my house. But I'm going to try to make it so I survive the hurricane. I can't stop the hurricane. Can't stop it from coming. I'm going to be in the midst of it. But I want to make sure I'm able to be there once the hurricane stops. And that's how I see COVID. I mean, I want to make sure that I'm still around once this pandemic relents. And hopefully, by my not giving it to somebody, it's going to slow it down even more and stop.
Get the info. Get the info.
Stay informed. It's a new day with Rip Daniels, the number one talk show in South Mississippi on Jay-Z 94.5.
Life and fame.
just too bad. Got to think about it. Good morning again, folks. The name of the show is It's a New Day, where there's no such thing as a right or wrong opinion. Give us a call to express yours, 228-896-9455. Getting back to the phones here as quickly as we can. Cole was in line, wanted to talk about Biden and vaccination. Good morning again, Cole. How are you, sir?
I'm doing well, Mr. Evans. Thank you for taking my call.
Thank you for calling.
I was calling to see, let me ask you this, Ro. Do you think, let's say, 85% of people who are voluntarily going to take the vaccination, do you think 85% of them have taken the vaccination already?
Okay, ask me that question again, please.
Of the people that you think will voluntarily take the vaccination, would you say 85% of them have already done so?
Okay, I'm having trouble understanding. So the folks who would volunteer to take the vaccine, do I think that the vast majority of those folks who would volunteer have already taken it? Is that the question?
So the reason I'm saying right now, I only see, like, from right now, people who are being threatened by the job, just like the previous caller, people that are being mandated to take the vaccination are the ones that's taking it now. And everybody else is the ones who just refuse to take it. Would you say that's accurate?
Okay, so I'm trying to get a handle on your questioning here. So
my question.
Am I of a mind to say that the folks who would get a vaccination at all
voluntarily,
have they mostly already gotten vaccinated? Is that the first part of the question?
Yes, most of those people have already gotten vaccinated.
Most likely. I know that there are still some holdouts. I know that folks are still, you know, kind of on the fence. We just heard from someone who is leaning toward getting it, but has not yet gotten it.
His employees forcing him, so that's not voluntary.
Okay, I got what you're saying. But I think that he you know, with that conversation with his relative, kind of had a mind made up and. The employment is just an extra factor here. If I'm not mistaken, he can call and correct me if I am. But I would say most likely those folks who would volunteer to get a vaccination have already gotten vaccinated. Yes.
Yes. Okay. The reason why I'm asking these questions is I do believe there's going to be a mandate for the vaccination eventually for everyone. And I would like to see if that's the case, that if there's no way around that, I would like to see Biden go ahead and implement that if that's what he's going to do, because the longer he waits, the closer it is to 2024, and he's going to need recovery time because it's going to put a bad taste in a lot of people's mouth. He's going to need recovery time to show the numbers are going down and show that the mandatory vaccination worked and to show it was a good thing. Do you agree with that?
Well,
if he's going to do it now versus wait, so he doesn't have any comeback time?
Well, before I answer your question, I have to ask you one. Why do you think he is capable of doing that? Now, forced quarantine is one thing. If someone is found to have been, have already contracted COVID-19, that's another thing. But what exactly in his range of power gives you that impression that Biden could even do that?
Because it's going to come down to an issue of basically like a health crisis. And in doing a health crisis, especially like during wartime, and we're not in wartime, obviously, but the president can declare a declaration if there's a health crisis, just like if there was an outbreak of tuberculosis or whatever. There's a declaration that can be declared. Now, I don't know how much of the Congress, how much of the Senate has to go along with it, but it is possible.
Yeah.
To force a vaccination. But you have to have a whole lot of people in Congress on board, and the chance of that happening right now is hardly at all.
Yeah. That's going to be very, very, very contentious. Now, forcing, vaccination of federal employees is one thing. Forcing vaccination of just the common man is a whole other thing. But if he were to find the ability to do that, which I don't think he has, I could be wrong, but I doubt it. I think that maybe the idea of getting it done before, you know, an election is kind of beside the point, because if that is the case, if the president actually says, oh, well, we're going to force vaccination, we're going to mandate vaccination for anyone who's not already been vaccinated, you got a lot of bigger problems to worry about than getting reelected. Like the pandemic being so far out of control that that's even an option for him to take. And I'm not saying that, you know, he cannot 100% do it. He can do it for his own employees in the executive branch, for sure. He's done it. But he's going to have to really pull together a coalition of the willing, not to misquote a former president, to be able to pull this off. I do think he's going to have the support of Congress. I don't think it's going to be a unilateral decision, whether there's an executive order or a state of emergency or not. Like I said, him going and enforcing a quarantine is one thing, but him forcing you to get a shot is a whole other thing. Is that
Evans, if the medical experts continuously say it's good that people are getting vaccinated, but this virus still can mutate, and the more it mutates because of people spreading it and a lot of people not getting vaccinated, the vaccination at that point in time is going to become ineffective. So it's best to get everybody vaccinated. And as long as COVID ain't going nowhere, let's just get that straight. It's not going anywhere. So as long as out there mutating, we're at risk of the vaccination becoming ineffective. And the only way to stop it is for pretty much everybody getting vaccinated. Am I correct on this?
Well, I still see an issue here, because even if you attempt to force vaccination, if there are folks who somehow skirt that policy, who don't get vaccinated, who do have COVID-19, it's still, you're right, the ability is still there for it to spread. It's not going anywhere. But I think that beyond vaccination, as long as people refuse to mask, refuse to social distance, refuse to quarantine students in schools and folks at work when they are testing positive, it doesn't matter if you do force vaccination, there's still going to be loopholes there, which is, you know, why myself personally had chosen to get vaccinated, because like Rip said earlier, I want every weapon at my disposal to fight against the enemy that I'm faced with now.
You know what, Cole? Actually, when you look at many of the vaccines that started, they had a rocky start. I mean, don't think that people embrace polio vaccine. And although they were seeing kids in those big iron lungs, there was still a reluctance of parents and others. You know, they disbelief. So, and by the way, the vaccine then had, I mean, every year we had to have a booster. I mean, that was a reason why in public schools they had there was shot day, you know, and you had to have a booster just to get to the point whereby there was a vaccine so effective that no kid that I know of got polio. So, mm-hmm. but what the CDC had at its disposal was the ability to quarantine. No, you're not going to give you a shot, but you can't come here. Or we can quarantine you. There were actual locations where, you know, children could be taken when they got it. Or if, in fact, really just when they got it. It wasn't just to the hospital. It was, well, okay, you got polio, you can't come here. We've got to now isolate you from anyone. And there are laws that say that the government can, in fact, do that, more so than saying we are going to have to give you this vaccine. But I think it's under the guise, like Rose said, of quarantine that it can happen. But it was always a rocky start.
Okay, thank you. That's straightened up. I appreciate that. That's straightened up. Thank you.
Yeah, it always has been a rocky start. I mean, diphtheria, all of this has been a rocky start. Now, I'm not sitting here trying to sell anybody on it. I really do feel that we still are in a position, don't have a choice, but to really focus on getting tests and finding out who has it and focusing on the quarantine. Or else it's going to continue to mutate. I mean, that's just what viruses do. And although some scientists might disagree with what they think the vaccine is the way to do it, I think my suggestion is being proven right. We've had the vaccine now going on over a year, and we've had some significant outbreaks, and now there's two other COVID strands out there that we got to deal with, the mu
strand and R1 strand, and R1, both are considered as potentially being more contagious and more virulent.
Coupled with Delta and Lambda still being here. Yeah.
Hang on, Uncle Mike, you're next. We'll be back.
Get the info. Get the info.
Stay informed. It's a new day with Rip Daniels. The number one talk show in South Mississippi on Jay-Z 94.5.
Didn't know that love could change ya. Then I woke up to a stranger. After all this time I thought that I you and I was never debating. Now it's up for conversation. Tell me, was it all a lie? I'm confused. But then you say what I wanna hear, cause you know it's gonna get me here. Every time I say that I'm
all right, folks, good morning to you. Rip Daniels here. Thank you for joining us. The show is called It's a New Day. It's only one rule now. There's no such thing as a right or wrong opinion. I want to get back to this. I know I don't have much time. Let's go out west, out to Uncle Mike here. Uncle Mike, how you doing, man?
I'm pretty good. How you doing, Rip?
I'm doing good, bro.
Good, good. Well, I got my booster.
Well, good.
And so,
Pfizer? Pfizer or Moderna?
Yeah, Pfizer. Yeah, Pfizer. Yeah, you might want to go ahead and get yours early, too.
Why?
Well, if you remember, the Johnson & Johnson had about a 75% success rate as opposed to a 95% with the Pfizer.
Effective, yeah.
Yeah, so the booster, they're going to have to, you know, you're going to have to get one anyway, so.
Yeah, they were saying that it is good if it's 2 months after you've had the first one, but it's even better if it's 6 months after, like 9%. Nine times better if I wait six months.
No, that's good. You remember what your boy Donald John said about testing? It wasn't like what you said. Slow the testing down.
Yeah, right. Slow the test. That's exactly right. If you didn't test that much, you wouldn't get that many that have it.
Nobody. That was right. No. He said the virus will just go away.
It'll
just like be like a miracle. It'll just go away. It's like having an imbecile drive you a car or a retarded person. You know what I'm saying?
Well, no, I wouldn't say that. I can tell you those individuals who are physically and mentally challenged are not nearly as repugnant as the last guy. But let me ask you this: do you find that now, of course, Gavin is one. Do you find that people there out in Cali are taking it upon themselves to wear a mask, social distance, and all of that? You think?
I think most people are here. I think most people are.
Really?
Mm-hmm. Now you do have I have been to some bars where no one had a mask on, so you know I didn't go back there. But and in Mexico in Tijuana. There's some clubs you go to, and you know, very few people have masks on, you know, except the employees. So,
are you finding? Are you finding that in Mexico? Since you mentioned Tijuana, are you finding that Mexico is being hit as hard as the United States right now with this Delta variant?
I'm sure. I mean, it really doesn't. Geographically speaking, it doesn't really, you know, change. If I have the virus in California, you have the virus in Mississippi, is the virus, you know?
Right. One last thing. It's been a while since I was there in San Diego. Could you describe to my audience what it's like going to and from Tijuana on any given day across the border?
Thousands of people across the border every day. I park my car normally on the American side, and then I walk over, and then I'll catch a cab where I want to go. And then, you know, some people drive. That's their, you know, that's their choice. But I just choose that it seems to be a little less
quicker.
Dangerous for your car.
And quicker in some cases.
And quicker, yeah.
But it's hundreds of thousands of people. I was just struck by how big the lanes were.
Oh, yeah. It's like
going and
10
coming.
Lanes.
I don't think people who have not seen it, have not been there at the border, understand just how many cars and trucks are going to and from Mexico.
Yeah, I know. It's, well, if you don't know, you don't know. I mean, you know, that's typical. I don't know Mississippi knowledge.
Yeah.
So.
Well, but I mean, I guess the thing is that the people crossing the border every day, the job of that border patrol is incredible. I mean, that stopping someone from coming across, even there, hundreds of thousands of cars, and they don't stop every car.
You know? No, but you know, they now I think they have like an X-ray machine.
They have X-ray,
X-ray
yeah.
the whole car.
That's right.
And I'm like, I didn't want to be in that, but you know, it is what it is.
All right, Uncle Mike, got to move on. Appreciate it, Doc. You get the last word.
Yes, I was telling Rue. I said, why the Caucasian buy land, and I believe it's Arab or Arab or something buy hotels. And Indian, they buy something else good, but black people, what do they buy?
Well, I think they buy cars. There's no doubt about that. I think we also buy land, some of us. I mean, I when you generalize like that.
The majority of them buy BS, though.
Well, yeah, I don't know. I don't know about that.
You know, you're at
the Four Corners, and I want you to know that land was bought by African Americans. All of that.
Well, that's where I'm up here. But, you know, that's part of my mission, to get them to come to school up here so I can school them and bring you on in and we can talk about this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So they buying the wrong thing. They can spend the money on anything but land and, you know, something they can build.
Mm-hmm. I know that's right, brother. Well, I can't wait until this pandemic relents, because we are definitely going to be right up there where you are, brother. There's no doubt about it. But if you don't know where you're going, we ain't able to take you there.
WJZD FM Long Beach, Ocean Springs, Moss Point, Gulfport, the all new JZ 94.5.